Amen. We're reading Psalms 15. Psalms 15. It's okay to stand for the word.
Amen.
They used to stand all day.
Yeah.
8 hours at a time sometimes, just listen. Psalms 15 reads, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly,
well,
and worketh righteousness,
yep,
and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbors, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor, in whose eyes is a vile person is contented. But he honoreth them that fear the Lord.
Yes, sir.
He that sweareth to his own heart, hurt, and charges not. He that putteth not out his money,
okay,
to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. I've read to you Psalms 15 in its entirety. May the Lord have blessed to reading, hearing, and doing of his holy.
Prayer time.
Yep.
Let us prepare our hearts and minds to talk to our Heavenly Father. And like I always say, we all can talk to Him at the same time. That's what's so great about it, that He has no limit. And we all can call Him up.
Yep.
Tell Him what we want. Let's tell Him this morning that we lift our pastor up to Him and his wife as she went through some sickness. Let's lift one another up to Him. Let's tell Him to touch those who don't know Him and the partner that sin to, that He touched them, that they might come running asking, what must I do to be saved? We just need Him this year. Like I said, we have a lot of things coming before the election this year. Let's pray for those who are running for office, thinking about running, and those who are rerunning, and we know what they all about, that we get in and do our job. That we vote, get registered to vote, and do the things. And let's for our census also, they're going to be this year, let's prepare to make sure our families and people that we know maybe not aware of it, that, because it has a lot to do with some benefits and things that we might get and not get. It depends. So it's a lot of things attached to those things. So let's prepare, pray for all that, that we be obedient, that because we living in a world that we have to know the laws. So let's recognize the law and do what we're supposed to do. Amen?
Amen.
Our Father God, the maker and creator of all things, the one who sits high and looks low, that knows all about us, knows our ups and knows our downs, knows our coming and going. We come as someone we know how this morning just to say thank you for your son Jesus who hung and bled and died on the Calvary cross. And we just want to say thank you this morning, Father. We come this morning, Father, because we need you, and we can't do nothing without you. We need you as we walk this Christian journey, Father, because sometimes the road get rough and the hills get hard to climb. But we ask that you walk with us, talk with us, and encourage us as we walk, Father. Encourage us to be bold as we walk, Father, that when we walk by someone need help, that we take the time to help them.
Yes.
We walk by someone that might be needing witness into, we take the time to tell them about you, that you died out on Calvary Cross for all our sins. We just ask you, Father, that as we walk this Christian journey, help us to be bold.
Yep.
That we tell everybody about our Lord and Savior. We come now, Father, asking you blessing upon our pastor this morning. Asking that you touch him this morning. Continue to lead and guide him.
Yes, sir.
The way you would have him to go. We ask blessing upon his wife this morning, Father.
Yes, sir.
You know what she's standing in need of, Father. Touch right now, Father. Then, Father, we ask you blessing the sick and afflicted, whatever they might be, Father. You know who they are, Father.
Yep.
We ask that you touch them also, Father. Then, Father, we ask that you touch those who don't know you in the free part of their sin this morning, Father. That your word would penetrate their minds and heart this morning, Father. They come running asking, what must I do to be saved this morning, Father? Father God, we asking and thanking you for those ones who are going to be baptized this morning, Father. Continue to help us to put our arms around them this morning, Father. That we mentor them in spiritual ways and encourage them, Father. Because we know they're babes in Christ, Father. But that we be strong for them, Father. Because Satan is on the job. He's mad. Because he knows there's a one that he's lost. So we must keep our arms around them, encouraging them, lifting them up to you, Father. That you be with them in good times and bad times, in ups and downs, Father. Father God, we ask that you bless the remaining of this service this morning, Father. Bless Pastor as he stands to declare your word this morning, Father. Father, we ask that you bless this month that has been set aside for a special group of people, that it's Black History Month this month, Father. Things that we have been able to do, Father, we ask and thank you for able. But we ask and blessing for as we go forward, Father, as we serve you and lift you up, Father, that you continue to make us strong in declaring your word. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. I know it was the blood for me. I know it.
Good morning. This evening we will have communion. Also, today is the beginning of celebrating Black History Month. We have some different activities during the whole month. They are listed here in the program. We will have a dinner on February the 16th. And we're asking you to wear the different colors. On Tuesday, February the 4th, at 6 o'clock, the NAACP will be hosting a Black History event at the Morrison Reese Library. And refreshments will be provided by Michael Davis, so please try to attend. And on Monday, February the 10th, there's Medical Monday, and it begins at 1 o'clock, and it's at Central United Methodist. And she's asking everyone to wear red, and also a lot of people turn out, so please get with Sherry and make your reservations so she'll know how to prepare for lunch. So if you're planning on going, please get with Ms. Sherry Harlan Davis. We also would like to welcome our visitors, First Friends Church, who has came out to worship with us today. So we welcome you. We now will have Sister Vanessa Mason.
Praise the Lord, Mount Olive.
Praise the Lord.
It is Black History Month. We're going to be brief, but each Sunday this month, we will highlight a man and a woman of our church that has made Black history. So it's called Black History Maker, Who Am I? We will also have trivia questions after that, a couple of trivia questions. Okay, y'all ready?
Okay.
I was born January the 3rd. I attended school in Richmond, Indiana, Muncie, Indiana, and Marion, Indiana. In my lifetime, I was an administrator, board member, they're shouting it out to me already, English teacher, head coach, trustee, mentor, vice president of community affairs, basketball forward, track and field long jump champion, vice president of institutional advancement, and a college president. I am a Black history maker because I was the first African American in Richmond, Indiana to have a clubhouse named in my honor. Who am I? I am Avis Martin Stewart. I was born September 19th. I attended and completed school at Richmond High School and Ivy Tech Community College. In my lifetime, I was a manager, a court liaison, an usher ministry president, a wife of 23 years, a mother of three, and a grandmother of five. My favorite color is royal blue. And I am affectionately known to others as TT and T-Maw. I am a Black history maker because I was the first African American in Richmond, Indiana to hold the position of court liaison for the Wayne County Sheriff's Department. Who am I? Wait until we finish the entire question with the choices before you answer. And then if you would like to speak up a little louder so we can hear. Sister Diane is going to help me watch for people. We have a basket of prizes up here. Okay? Okay, here we go. Somebody has to watch for me. Somebody watch right there. Okay, here's the first one. What was the name of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s father's church? Number one, Atlanta Tabernacle. Number two, Ebenezer Baptist. Number three, Atlanta Southern Baptist. And number four, Southern Church of the People.
Mr. Gibson. Yes, we have.
Ebenezer Baptist Church.
Ebenezer Baptist, absolutely. He can pick something out of the basket. Very good. Thank you, Robert. All right. I'll wait till she gets back before I read the next one so we can chip up the watch. Okay, y'all ready? This is the last question. Remember, please wait till I finish the entire question with the choices, okay? At this time of her historic bus incident, what was Rosa Parks' occupation? Number one, hospital orderly. Number two, drugstore clerk. Number three, high school cafeteria worker. And number four, department store seamstress. What was her occupation?
Mark Chambers?
Seamstress.
Absolutely. She was a department store seamstress. Thank you very much. God bless you all.
Amen. Amen.
Third Sunday of March for Marnette graduation. Reverend Ron Owens, and so we're trying to clear everything with that. So the third Sunday morning will be our Marnette graduation for those who completed from 101 through 106 and all in between. And then we'll be getting scheduled the next round of classes. So we begin preparing for that. But the third Sunday of March, make sure all your family come from California, Texas, and Canada, and wherever else. So this is a big day for those who have studied in the various levels of study that we have to get your certificate and also another gift we're going to give you away. So we're trying to move it up. At some point we'll have tassels and all that. It'll be coming later on down the line. And then, of course, remember those who are in the hospital, nursing homes, and at home. And I want to thank you all for prayers for Donna. She's home, came home yesterday.
Amen.
A lot of pain, but that's part of the process. Yeah. As a matter of fact, sometimes you gotta go through pain in order to heal. So just think about that, not only physically, but sometimes spiritually.
Amen.
And so keep that in mind and in your prayers as the days move forward. And then finally tonight, we're going to be here for Lord's Supper. We'll come back at 5, and we'll be out in plenty of time for you all to see the greatest team win. We'll have plenty of time to get home and take care. If you don't, you'll get some DVRs. We're not going to move you along. Queen Elizabeth, one of them, said to one of her 8 husbands, "I won't hold you long." Y'all, some of y'all got it.
Thank you. Time to worship our Lord and give it.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. It's a blessing to be excited about giving back to the Lord what He has given to you. Remember, let's continue to give and support God's kingdom. With our card, stand up before our tithes and offerings, benevolence, and building funds. Let's continue to support the ministry. For Brother Vanley to stand and be for our pastoral support. Sarah, you support him from our tithes and offerings. So let's continue to support our pastor. Amen?
Amen.
Lord God, we come now thanking you for the gift we're about to receive. We ask for your blessing, like only you can, Father. Bless everyone that have it to give. Bless everyone that have a desire and have not. In your Son Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Will the members of the congregation this side please stand for our direction to usher the river, please? Depart from evil and do good.
seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles.
May we pray. Heavenly Father, just once more that we just want to thank you for coming before you, Father, and just with praise and thanksgiving.
That's right.
Father, we just are so humbled to just be before you for all your grace and all your mercy, Father. And Father, we want to ask that you take this offering and use it for the uplifting and glorification of your people. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. God good. Can we give him a hand clap of praise? Ain't he worthy? This morning, he's so worthy. He didn't have to let us get up this morning.
All right.
I feel exuberant this morning because God has allowed me to see another day. I don't know what tomorrow gonna bring, but I know what he let me make it from yesterday to right now. And he's worthy. Oh, yeah. He's so worthy. It's prayer time.
Yes.
And we need prayer more now than ever.
Yes.
It's almost to the point you can't even breathe the air because of diseases in the air. We need prayer. God is able. I know he's able to answer prayer. He's able. I don't care what you're struggling with this morning. He's able to lift up a bow down here. My grandmother said he gave ease to a troubled heart. Won't you come to the altar? Pray for the one in front of you, the one behind you, the one beside you. Even pray for yourself. And you know, say something else about prayer. Say, in order for your prayer to get through, say, God says, if I allow iniquity in my heart, say, God will not. That means you got to make sure you are right.
Yes.
You know, we think the smoking and drinking and all that stuff. No, but it goes deeper than that.
Yes.
Hatred, jealousy, envy, all of that. Yes. All of it. I want my prayer to get through. And what I like about God is you ain't got to worry about being put on hold. You ain't got to worry about going through 9 or 10 telecommuters before you get to where you need to get, because my God is omnipresent, meaning he's everywhere. He can hear everybody at the same time, whoever you may be. And you ain't got to tell him to go there because he's already there. Wife,
yes.
She have a speedy recovery.
Yes.
Pray for our pastor.
Yes.
Pray for this world. Pray for the country. Pray for your environment. Because we all stand in need of prayer. I'm here on my grandmother's prayer.
Yeah.
God is able. Shall we bow our heads? Lord, we come now. Not that we've been so good.
Say yes.
Not that we've been so righteous.
Well.
Haven't dotted every I, haven't crossed every T. Some things you told us to do, we didn't do.
Say that.
Yeah.
some things we did we should not have done. But I will say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For looking beyond our fault.
Yep.
And seeing our need. Lord, we glorify your name this morning because you been so good to us.
Thank you, Jesus.
So good.
Thank you.
Even when we didn't deserve it, Lord, you've been good to us.
Yes, yes, yes.
Say, so we're all sinners saved by grace, and thank you for your grace and your mercy. Just thank you because of the God of who you are. Besides, there is no other. But I do know you do. I ask that you touch right now.
Touch, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. If somebody needs a healing, touch right now, Lord. If somebody needs a financial blessing, Lord, touch right now, Lord. If somebody's looking for a sickness to overtake them to get out of their way, Lord, we ask that you touch right now. And then, Lord, somebody here just needs to say thank you for being who that you are. Realizing that you created the heavens and the earth, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for last night flying down and this morning's early rise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for our hearing, Lord. Thank you for our seeing. Thank you for our smelling. The small thing that we take so much for granted. Thank you for what you have done.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you for what you will do.
Yes,
and thank you for what you're going to do.
Yes.
And then most of all, Lord, we thank you for your son, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Who died on Calvary Cross.
Yes.
He was buried and got up early Sunday morning and said all power.
All power.
Lord, we glorify your name.
Yes.
Because guess you are worthy. You're so worthy. With this holy hand this morning, you are worthy. This is my prayer. If I overmeet anything, Lord, charge it to my mind and not my heart. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in my sight. Our Lord, our strength, and our redeemer. And let the whole house say, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Yeah. today.
Yes, Lord.
Saying, have your way.
Yes, your way, Lord.
You have our permission to take us and do with us what you want in this worship experience.
Yes.
Pray that you just help us to be able to focus and concentrate on your word today.
Help us, Lord.
We may gain a lesson and apply it to our life and then share with others.
Yes.
We just thank you for the privilege of praying.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Pray now that you forgive me of my sin, cleanse me from unrighteousness. Stand in and speak through me. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight.
That's right.
O Lord, my strength and my
Lord.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Again, preacher. Chambers, deacons, and you use one of the family, visitors as well. Good morning and God bless you. Today, we're already in the month of February.
Yeah.
Time is moving.
It is.
You don't want to hold you long and look at Hebrews 10, 19 through 25. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verses 19 through 25. Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Somebody, I don't know if it was this week or when it was called church, but no, is the pastor making a coffee? Somebody said Hebrews. Hebrews, the coffee. Some of y'all get that on the way home. Amen. Hebrews, the 10th chapter. And Ruth said, not that one. 19 through 25. Reads as follows. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us, to the veil, that is to say, his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water.
Yes, sir.
Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering.
That's right.
For his faithful that promise. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as a man of some is, but exhorting one another so much the more, as you see the day approaching. I just want to simply talk about, let's come to church. Let's come to church. Can you say that after me? Let's come to church. You know, in a time, church is been put on the back burner. Many people's lives, agendas, and times. And I remember not long ago in our own city, Boys and Girls Club, we opened on Sunday. We were from 600 to 800 children and parents at a basketball league through a certain time. During the same time, church was going on. So we can't say there are no people.
Yeah.
Can't say there are no young people.
Nope.
For some reason or another, people with aspirations to the NBA and WNBA have superseded the church. Just let me drop this on you before we even started yet. I didn't start on Facebook. But let me just say this. You have 35 to 40 jobs that only last 5 years for some, I don't know how many millions of people who aspire to get. And I'm talking about getting to the NBA or WNBA. So that's not, whatever you do, even if you do make it, it's only an average of 5 years. And so you got to figure out what else you're going to do the rest of your life. But don't put God on the back burner. Parents, don't abort your child's worship experience running off to the game.
Amen.
Amen. So let's come to church.
y'all mad at me already, I still remember. My baby gonna make it, okay. You make sure your baby's a little tired too. Amen. The doctrine or teaching of the New Testament church has a very unique place among the many great and fundamental doctrines of the Bible. The Bible clearly points out that aside from the home and family, the church is the most powerful institution for the promotion of good and the only institution that preaches the gospel of eternal salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. The church is an everlasting fortress which neither time nor the ravages of war can destroy. For more than 20 centuries, the church has stood, survived, and prospered under the pressures, whether it be from within or from without. The church has weathered every storm on the rough seas of time without lowering her sails. She stood the test of ages and outlived every tyrant and every evil influence since her birth. The church has proved every man false who predicted that she would soon fall, and has come to naught. She has remained stable even during the brutal persecution she received in her early stages of infancy. When Herod, he delivered his great oration, King Herod, and had received the applause of men, when he spoke again at the church with all that nonsense, he fell dead and was eaten by worms. His disdain of the church was his final doom. And the lesson we can learn from King Herod is you better be careful what you say about and what you say to the church. You need to understand that any disdain that you may have for the church may also be your final doom. The church is in fact an earthly institution, but it is of divine origin. Heaven is its headquarters. A lot of times people say, you know, when they want us to visit, or they visit us, every once in a while they say, well, I'm a member of the Mount Carmel Baptist Church where there's Holy Ghost headquarters. No, the Holy Ghost headquarters is in heaven.
All right.
Amen. Everybody got no corner on the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
Amen. His headquarters is in heaven. God thought it in eternity past and brought it into being in time as a living organ. God's purpose for it is to bring fallen, sinful, and wayward men back to himself by the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. One writer says, God thought it in eternity past. Jesus bought it at Calvary, and the Holy Spirit sealed it at Pentecost with the seal of God's everlastingness. The church is here to stay as a lighthouse to the world. It's here to stay as the true foundation. It's here to stay for the saving of lost souls. It's here to stay for Christian fellowship. It's here to stay for the communion of the saints, which we'll be doing tonight at 5. It's here to stay to represent heaven. And it's here to stay as the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Cultures change with succeeding generations. Kingdoms rise and fall, but the church lives on. There are those who say the church is failing, but I beg to differ. Too much has gone into it for it to fall. And heaven went through too much expense for it to fall. Christ died and rose for it, and he didn't do that in vain. His thorn-crowned brow, his riveted feet, the nails in his loving hands, and the piercing of his side was no laughing matter. Heaven declared that through the blood of Christ, which was the price he paid for the church, it would stand as long as time shall last, and would serve as a safe haven for the children. And it is out of the boundless love of God that he wills and works
in and by and through his church, that he might accomplish his eternal purpose of grace, as we'll see in our text today. The book of Hebrews was written to Jewish converts. Their first meetings took place, which were in synagogues, and their first controversies concerned adherence to Jewish laws. Their first critics derided them as Jewish extremists. But for the first Jewish believers, believing in Christ raised many questions. What about the temple and the animal sacrifices? What about the law of Moses? They're believing in Christ negate so much that they had grown up believing that, it was really enough to put your trust in Christ alone? Answers were needed right away for those who lived during the time of the writing of the book of Hebrews, because tolerance would soon give way to torture and execution. Believing in Jesus Christ would become a life or death proposition. And the temptation for the Jewish believers to go back to their old ways would be irresistible unless they could know for sure that they had made the right choice. And brothers and sisters, when life turns on you, when situations become dire, and when challenges come in your life, you need to know you made the right choice. Oh, you've heard the song. Some folk would rather have houses and land. Some folk choose silver and gold. But these things they treasure and forget about their soul. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. And the chorus goes on and say, the road is rough. And the going gets tough. And the hills are hard to climb. Started out a long time ago. And there is no doubt in my mind that you can do what you want to do. You can stay home on Sunday if you want to stay. But I've decided to make Jesus my choice. No, no one knows for sure who wrote the book of Hebrews. The Coptic church believed that Paul was the writer. The Coptics are those in Alexandria in Egypt. And although they believed that Paul was the author, the language of the book of Hebrews is too polished. And Paul spoke a Greek that was common language among the people. So this polished language in the Hebrew points to the fact that Paul was perhaps not the author of the book. Others say Tertullian, who believed that Barnabas was the writer of the book of Hebrews. Because Barnabas is from Cyprus, the region in Greece where a polished, cultural, educated Greek was spoken. And then some of the church reformers, such as Martin Luther and many others in his era, thought because of the polished language that it was Apollos who was the writer. Because Apollos was an intellectual who had a good grasp of the Greek language. And my pastor said Apollos is one who could say it. But Priscilla and Aquila said that with all of the polish, Mr. Apollos, you need the Holy Ghost. So all of these, although the identity of the writer of the book of Hebrews is difficult to trace, the message is quite easy to find. Many Jewish believers wanted to reverse their course in order to avoid persecution because they had trusted in Jesus Christ. But the writer stopped them in their tracks, exhorting them in chapter 6 to go on to perfection. His appeal is based on the superiority and the sufficiency of Jesus Christ. The Jewish sacrificial system and priestly rule pales in comparison to the finished work of Christ on the cross. The writer insists that Jesus is better than everything that has come before him. Jesus is better than the angels because angels worship him. Jesus is better than Moses because he created Moses. Jesus is better than all of the Aaronic priesthood because they sacrifice all kinds of time for all kinds of reasons, but Jesus' sacrifice was once and forever. And Jesus is better than the law because through him he mediates a better covenant. Therefore, in verse 19, it recalls the therefore in Hebrews 4 and 16.
Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need.
All right.
Mm-hmm. The passage contains some very important challenges that we need to hear this morning at Mount.
Okay.
These challenges are identified by three let us imperatives. Each of these let us statements tell us something we should not be doing. These commands tell us that the faithful need the fellowship of the body of Christ.
All right.
And as a result, we should get up Sunday morning and make our way to church. Oh, live streaming has its place for those unable to physically attend church. There are some churches who have live streaming where, like today, their worship experience is on internet, live. And that's okay. If you're sick or you're homebound, and you want to have some semblance of participation at your church, I understand. But what is not healthy is someone who just wants to lay home in bed and watch church from home, from your 15-inch laptop. That's what I call being a bedside Baptist, laying down and loving. Let's see you live stream your job.
All right.
And see how long you'll be there.
Yeah. Well,
www.job.com, you clock in. You sitting up there in your pajamas, drinking your coffee, logging in from home. You don't want to be bothered with your coworker. You just log in and say present for the day. But if you could get up and go to work on Monday, it is God who gives you the strength to make work. Nothing ought to get in the way of you coming to church. But we got to get more serious about this matter called church. Because when life gets sour, you're going to need the church. When your life becomes soiled because you've had a run-in with sin, and sin has gotten the best of you, and you are dirty and filthy because of your wrestling match with sin, you're going to need the church. When life brings on you sorrow, death, and some tragic situation, you're going to need the church. And then when life knocks on your door and drops some sickness on your doorstep, you're going to need the church. Oh, when I look back at the old folks crowd here in the city of Richmond, then when I look back on my family in the South, in Kentucky, the trips we used to make, that was our big thing, going to Kentucky. That's a big deal now. We used to make those trips in the summertime. They didn't have any money. People in our neighborhood, people in the South. I'm 12, 13, 14 years old, and they're asking me for $10.
Yeah.
My paper route money was hard earned. Dad told me, don't give Tom no more money for you. He was a one eye, he just wanted a bottle of wine. You see, CJ, boy, give me $10. They don't give no more money. A lot of them didn't have money. A lot of them had dropped out of school in the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade because they had to work the land in order to survive. They had to take care of the livestock. Many of them had newspaper on their walls that served as wallpaper.
Yes, sir.
All week long, they were nobody. They were cooks and chauffeurs. They were janitors and domestics and gardeners, and they took care of other people's children. They scrubbed floors on their knees in order to have some Joe Bacon and pinto beans and cornbread for our household children. And while they had to say Miss and Mister, they were called by and out of their name. Every drinking fountain, every back door, every restaurant counter, every piece of legislation, and every courtroom said to them, you don't matter. They tell them that they were nothing and nobody. And as far as they were concerned, they were nothing and nobody. Monday through Saturday. But on Sunday morning, something got a hold of them. On Sunday morning, something happened in their lives. And something happened at God's house that didn't happen at their house. So they made their way to church. They didn't log in, www.job.com. They didn't do that. They made their way
Yes.
So this is not an auditorium. This is a sanctuary.
Yes.
The house of the living God.
Yes.
And I'm not making a speech. I'm declaring the oracles of God.
Wow.
And in this sanctuary, we have the blessed privilege of being in the presence of God.
Yes.
So whenever the privilege presents itself, you ought to get up.
Hallelujah.
Stand up,
yes.
Dress up,
yes.
Show up,
yes.
Look up,
yes.
And give God praise.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Last week, the song I learned from the late Dr. E.E. Stafford from Mount Tabor Baptist Church of Los Angeles, I'm glad to be in the circuit.
Yes.
One more
time. Yes.
I don't deserve to be here, and neither do you. I've sinned enough that God could have wiped me off the face of the earth. I made enough mistakes in my life that God could have destroyed me a long time ago. But I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad He let me live to come from the sanctuary.
Because
my step was almost gone. My feet had well nigh slipped when I considered how the wicked prosper and the righteous suffer. But then I went to the sanctuary. And there's something about coming to church that'll help get your mind right. There's something about being among God's people and hearing the gospel, hearing music and prayers. I'll let you know that I'm so glad. Trouble don't last. But there's a brighter day ahead. Weeping endures for a night. But stay there, hang in there. Don't give up because joy is going to ring your doorbell. Be not weary in well doing. In due season you'll reap if you faint not. It may look like what we're doing don't make sense. But keep on trusting God and you'll see that God will make a way out of no way. Verses 19 through 22, there's a let us inherit. Let us draw near. First of all, fellowship helps us to draw near. Sometimes we get bogged down on the church not being full of people. All across America, and many churches are on the decline. You have some places that are get hold 2,000. You might have 20 or 30. But let's not worry about a church full of people. Let's concern ourselves with people being full of church.
All
right. Today, somebody can come boldly because there was a time when we couldn't. In the Old Testament, they would approach God at a distance. And everybody. Then everybody, they couldn't approach him. As a matter of fact, only the high priest could come once a year on the Day of Atonement. They put a rope around his waist and bells on his tassels so that if he fell dead as a result of being defiled, they could drag him out. Because access was only gained and given to the high priest who met God's holy qualification. There was a veil, a curtain that separated the holy place from the most holy place. And everybody didn't have access. But one Friday at Calvary, Jesus died. And when he died, the Bible says the veil that separated the holy place from the most holy place was rent or torn from the top to bottom. Knocking out forever an intermediary between God and man. Now everybody can come boldly to the throne of grace to find mercy and grace in the time of need. Draw near. That's what fellowship means. We can draw near. We don't have to stay outside. We don't have to be scared to approach God. We don't have to be fearful to bring our sins and our shortcomings and our doubts to His throne. Our misgivings and our failures. We can draw near because of the blood of Christ. Not only can we come with boldness, but we have now gained access. We have a high priest. I don't need to confess my sins to some man who sinned just as much as me. I know somebody who's seated at the right hand of God with power. That when I sin, not if, but when I sin, I go to my high priest and he'll make intercession for me. We have access. We have a high priest, and because of his shed blood, we have clean hearts and new lives. It has nothing to do with what I did. Because salvation is not based on what I did, it's based on what's been done. I'm a wretch. I'm not worthy to even come in God's presence, but I've got an elder brother. I've got an advocate, a lawyer who goes before me. And when Satan accuses me of what I've done wrong, Jesus, my advocate with the Father,
Jesus, my Lord. Jesus, my high priest, stands up on the right hand of the Father and says, oh, yeah, he's guilty.
Yeah,
he was at the scene of the crime. Yeah, his fingerprints all over the place. But I paid for that on Calvary. And as a result, I've taken the punishment.
Yes, sir.
My blood washed away his sin and has given him a pure heart and a new life.
Yes, sir.
And you remember now, my blood reaches to the highest mountain, to the lowest. My blood gives strength from day to day to never lose its power.
Yes.
Anybody been here guilty and you came to church?
Yes.
And the Lord washed the guilt off your face and off your heart and off your soul.
Yes.
And now you're able to worship him with a pure conscience.
Yeah.
Not because you didn't sin, but because Jesus took care of it on the cross.
Yes.
No, we're not perfect. We're just forgiven.
That's right.
There's none righteous.
No, not one.
Yeah. Isaiah helps us. He says, woe is me, for I am undone.
Well,
I'm a man of unclean lips.
Yeah.
And I dwell in the midst of a people with unclean lips.
Yeah.
And he said, those seraphims took live coal from the altar and touched my lips.
Well,
and said, your iniquity is purged and your sin forgiven. Then after Isaiah said, I saw something. Then I sensed something. Then I heard something. And heard the voice of God say, who shall I see?
Yes.
And who will go for us?
Well,
then said I, here am I. Go ahead on and send me.
Yeah.
The only way I can go, I've got to be cleaned up. And the only one who can clean me up is Jesus the Christ.
Yeah.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again?
Wow.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Fellowship draws us near, but secondly, fellowship helps us hold fast. Verse 23 says, hold fast the profession of your faith, because he who promised is faithful. There's always the danger that we might turn back to the world. We're saved out of the darkness of our sin.
Yeah.
And if you don't watch yourself, you'll exchange one addiction for another. If you stop drinking, you might start gambling.
That's right.
If you stop gambling, you might start smoking weed again. There's always the thing y'all missing. There's always the danger. What you got away with.
That's right.
Matter of fact, talk about medicinal. The humorous note, Donald was in so much pain, he's going to use some CBD oil on the area. So he had to ask the doctor, and he said, CBD? Or the guy didn't. He said, this CBD? She said, yeah, you know, marijuana. I'm like, what did you say? It's warm, it's green. You don't have all that stuff in there. So there's a danger that what you got away from, you may go back to. The Bible says that the dog will return to his own vomit. The very thing that made the dog sick, he goes back and licks it up.
Come on.
1 John chapter 2 says, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they were of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out.
Yep.
That they might be made manifest that they are not of us.
Mm-hmm.
Brothers and sisters, you can come to church all you want. But until you see, it's the Lord. Your confession has to line up with your profession.
Right.
Your walk has to line up with your talk.
Mm-hmm.
We fail, we slip, we fall, and that's when the reason we come.
Yes.
So we can be energized and go out and try to do better the next time.
All right.
So let us draw near.
Yes, sir.
Let us hold fast. Then there's one more imperative. Thirdly, let us consider one another.
Mm-hmm.
Fellowship helps us look after one another.
Right.
Verses 24 and 25 talks about provoking one another and encouraging one another.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you ought to come to church, because something happens at the Lord's house.
Yeah.
There's something that goes on here that you could look for on your computer, look for on your phone, it won't be there. That's why you need to be around some flesh and blood people.
Yes,
you need to start being a part of a live worship and praise time.
Yes,
that'll provoke you to get in service.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't get that with a biscuit and a cup of coffee in your pajamas looking on a 15-inch laptop screen.
Well.
Now, the word provoking in the text is both negative and positive.
Okay.
To provoke negatively means to incite. People can use words to incite a riot. But on the positive side, provoke them means to stir up. That's why Paul told Timothy to stir up the gift. And for those of us who believe, you can't hear the name Jesus and not get stirred up. When you start thinking about where God brought you from, how many doors God has opened for you, how many prayers God has responded to on your behalf, how many times He forgave you when you messed up, and how many times He made a way when you said, look, I don't know how this happened. Because there's something that goes on in this house that's not the same as your house.
Yeah.
There's something that happens when we fellowship that when we're alone, this doesn't happen by ourselves.
Well,
sometimes I can shout for what God is doing in your life.
Yeah.
I can rejoice with you. And this lets me know that if God can bless you like that, the same God can bless me the same way. If God can make a way for you, I'm encouraged He can make a way for me.
Yeah.
If I open my mouth and tell God thank you, He'll do the same for me.
Mm-hmm.
Church is just not about shaking your head.
Well,
church is just not about clapping your hands.
Well,
it's about opening your mouth and giving God praise. Because He's worthy of you opening your mouth. He's worthy of you telling Him thank you.
Yes.
He's worthy of you calling on His name.
Yes.
I'm glad to be here in the fellowship.
Yes.
I'm glad God let me leave.
Yeah.
To stand up on a Sunday morning, not just to wave
come
a hand,
on, come on,
but also not only to shake my head, but to open my mouth and give Him praise and tell Him thank you for the many roads you brought me. Thank you for the storm you calmed in my life. Thank you for me. Thank you for opening doors for me. Thank you for being a way maker for me. Thank you for being a doctor when I was sick. Thank you for being a lawyer when I was in trouble. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. And most of all, thank you. Friday, died on Calvary, but early Sunday morning, got up with all power in His hand. And since He got up, I need to get up on Sunday morning and come on to church. I ought to come to church and wave my hand. I ought to come to church and greet my brother and sister. Come to church, say how you doing this morning. All to come to church, ask has God been good to you? Every day is a day of thanksgiving. We all come and praise Him together. Let's magnify Him, let's lift Him up. He worthy, we praise Him. What a
again. The gospel has been preached. The doors of the church are open. He said, come to church.
Yes.
Let us know.
Yes.
But I'm going to say, if you have not accepted Christ as your personal Savior, you need to come.
Yes, yes, yes.
John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And what I like about this part here is that he didn't leave nobody out. He said, and whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. He didn't leave nobody out. So I like that. As we stand, is there one this morning? Won't you come? Even if you don't have a church home, you ought to have a church home.
Yes, yes, yes,
yes. Even when moving, when you need to move from one place to another. But let me say this, see, if you die without Christ in your life, you're on your way to hell. That's just bottom line. And the thing about that is that you, once you get there, you cannot change your mind. Have the option now. While the blood is running warm in your veins. Is there one this morning? That's the white priest this morning. He said, come to church. Yeah, well, woke up this morning enthusiastic. Because God's been good to us. That Jesus died on the cross for us. That while we were yet sinners, he commended his love toward us. That while we were yet sinners, he died for the ungodly. The sinner saved by grace. Is there one this morning? Don't put off for the next minute. We used to say don't put off for tomorrow. I'm saying now don't put off for the next minute for what you can do right now. Because the next minute ain't promised. Is there one? As we say come to Jesus, is there one?
Just now.
listening to Pastor. Last Sunday he preached suddenly. This Sunday he's saying, come to church. He's trying to tell us.
Some had to fix their hair, others had to fix their weave or their wig. You know, do this, put it down the front. But they look in the mirror to prepare. But he's not concerned about that. He's concerned about the real you, what's on the inside of you. And if his son Christ does not reside inside of you, it don't matter what, you can die in your sleep and not ever see him. Or you can die with him in you and you crash into whatever it's going to be and you'll be with him.
Amen.
Main thing is not how you die, it's who you die.
Right.
Right. And so it'll happen suddenly. Some cases are prolonged, some cases are delayed. We don't know. Main thing, are you ready? Because the Lord is coming back. We are in a truth denial stage in this world.
Yeah.
Jesus said, I'm the way.
Yes,
the truth.
Yes,
ain't got to worry about him not being consistent.
Yeah.
Everything else in the world around us is not consistent.
Yeah.
Food expires.
Mm-hmm.
Cars we get from the showroom floor on the way to the junkyard.
Yes,
homes like fail. Catch on fire. Friends sometimes are fleeting and fake.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
People you love sometimes let you down.
Yes.
He's the only one consistent.
Yes, sir.
And I don't know why we run around chasing after everything else but him. So let's encourage others and let's ourselves come to church. And if you're not in Christ, give your life to Christ. Death will happen suddenly. Tonight we'll be back at 5 o'clock for the Lord's Supper.
Yes,
all people who have come and since before today and last week and beyond, if you just joined recently, either by a candidate for baptism or Christian experience, or you rededicated, we want you to come back tonight with the right hand of fellowship at 5 o'clock. The Super Bowl, I've never heard anybody say, we saw the Super Bowl, me and my husband got back together. Never heard of it. Or as a result of the Super Bowl, my child got saved.
Yeah, we do it.
Never heard of it. One of my mentors is a Redskins fan and his wife is a Cowboys fan.
Yeah.
They had to literally watch the game in separate rooms with those two
players. Yeah.
So if anything, they tear the pride of the family's heart.
Yeah.
I've never heard nobody say, well, you know, when I needed food and clothes and my light bill paid, I called the 49ers.
Yeah.
and the Chiefs, and they chipped in and paid my rent for a year. Never heard of it. Matter of fact, I dare you to call the 49 before you call Mount Olive today. People call us. I need help with my life bill. I need help with this. I need help with that. Call the 49ers or call the Chiefs. See what they'll do for you. You probably won't even get a call back. Amen. So come at 5. Communion. Lord's Supper's at 5. You'll be out in plenty of time. We're not going to rush, but you'll be out in plenty of time. To be home, get your chips and your pop and your water or your juice. That's it. Amen. Shall we stand? Reggie. And again, good to have our visitors. Thank you so much for joining with us. God bless you all. And you're more than welcome to come anytime. Amen.
Stain of sin, and his blood cleanses me deep down.
your blood.
Yes.
Everything else breaking down on us, but your blood's doing it.
Yes.
Thank you for the blood.
Thank you.
Pray now that you meet us as we prepare to return this evening.
Yes.
With the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ,
yes,
the love of God and sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. Shall we all sing together? Amen.
Thank you.
That's why, that's the big thing this time.
That's why
I told him, I said, they make money now. I said, United States, they make money like they never make.
You ain't got no choice.
So they ain't.
Yeah, because they can stop on that shit, because they all, they're right over there where they grow it. And they haven't stopped. They're talking about them farmers gotta live. But yet, if they don't live, somebody else is gonna die, because that's what, everything they pulling out is poison.
That's right, but I asked one of them, the men, the one guy, he gonna.
He gonna read if he want to.
I have no call.
He might read you something.
Yeah.
I said, man, how y'all do that stuff? He said.
I always do my life.
I said, what's the problem? He said, y'all been experimenting with it.
We experiment with.
Yeah, he said, I've been doing it all my life.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He said, now it's over here and y'all get to messing with it and changing it.
Yeah, they got
doing it in different ways.
And all that. What's the difference? Yeah, they experimenting with it now.
I like
taking this out too.
Yep.
That's the difference.
That's like they were talking about a girl from yesterday. They said somewhere they had cannabis in Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
They said they had 30 something overdoses in like 52 weeks.
Damn, really?
Yeah, and then they said it's been just as bad.